With all them, right? Well, now the question is, can we get this done by a robot? A robot sits inside the computer. A human worker sits in outside of the system. A robot will be sitting inside. And guess what? It will be more powerful than a human being, because it will have much more ways of doing things. So now we are going into a hybrid era of digital workforce, wherein human workforce and digital workforce will work together. The picture is showing you the physical robots, but there's nothing like a physical robot. It's just a software robot, just for the representation purpose. So now we are in an era where the digital workers and human workers will work together. So what is RPA? The simplest definition would be mimicking human actions. Mimicking human actions. Just like what you perform on computer softwares as a human being, same would be performed by the robot. Think about it. At the core, at the very basic elementary level, what do? When you interact with any software, whether it is the sophisticated moving $1 million from your account A to Swiss account, or you're just creating a list of items that you want to buy from the shopping mall in a notepad. For both the cases, you still use the same way of interacting with software. Notepad is a software, absolutely. A bank having the account management from where you are moving $1 million to your Swiss account, sure, that is also a software. And how do you interact? You interact with only three devices in principle. The monitor, wherein you get the information, you see the things. The keyboard, where you feed in the information. The mouse, wherein you click or get control or get focus of some UI element. You do nothing except the keystroke on the keyboard. There's only one labor item. The only labor that you and I perform is pressing a key. Yes, sometimes combination of keys like Control C, Control V, but we press keys. That's the only labor we do as a skilled worker. Similarly for mouse, only action that you do, only labor you do is clicking on the mouse buttons. Left, right, yes. Single click, double click, yes. But it's still click. And on monitor, you just simply see the things. That's how your eyes are working. So now if you have a corresponding parallel human organ involved, your eyes are basically looking at the things on the monitor. Your fingers are working on the keyboard and mouse. Your brain is sitting in middle, just transferring the messages from one end to the other end. Means the eyes to fingers and fingers for keyboard and mouse. And that's it. So if somehow I can mimic this action of getting information, punching in the keyboard actions, keystrokes, clicking the mouse buttons, well, can't I transfer that $1 million from local bank account to my Swiss account? Sure, I can. So simplest or complex, that doesn't matter. The point is that we have to just somehow mimic these human actions that we perform on software. And that is what RPA is all about. RPA is all about mimicking human actions on softwares, which are involved in a process. Process is our terminology in terms of what we want to achieve in the context of business in principle. So what are the processes which are suitable for RPA? Any process that is rule-based, workflow-driven. Workflow-driven means it's having a coordinated series of steps, very well defined up front, which you can very well automate using RPA. And it's repeatable. You do it one time, you do it 100 times, you do it every time the same way. Mostly the interaction is at graphical user interface level. End users typically deal with the UI level. And mostly it is graphical now. Many applications we are having in the desktop application form. Many applications are in the web application form. Documents, be it PDF, Excel, Word, images. And the processes where human tasks are heavy. These are done by human tasks, by the human workers. And typically these transactions, these repeatable tasks are involving huge, large and continuous volume. Think about of a account opening. That's a continuous one. It will happen every day virtually, maybe in hundreds. Think about claim processing, insurance claim processing, happening in thousands virtually every day. A big team is working for an insurance company. And mostly the data which is coming in is structured. Structure means it's well-defined and can be processed. So wherever you see these characteristics, you can think of RPA to automate that process. So instead of human beings working on that process involving multiple software applications in between, you can think of a software robot which can do the same job faster, accurate, more, in less money. All the four principal pillars for decision making are in favor of RPA. You can do more because robots can work 24/7, unlike human beings who can work only 40 hours a week, 8 hours a day. We commit mistake as a human being when we are tired, we are bored. Robots will not have that problem. So their work is going to be of higher accuracy. So they will do more and they will do it accurately. They will do it efficiently. They will do it faster. Something that I can do it in 1 hour, my robot can do it in 10 minutes. Faster, more efficient. And of course, it costs less overall for a robot to perform. So ROI is in favor of RPA. So why would someone not go for RPA if it is solving some problem in a business domain? And that is why the RPA is so popular right now that virtually every business is looking into it. So many projects are opening up. So many opportunities are opening up. So many projects are starting and companies are looking for building RPA teams to start the projects. The demand level is certainly very high as compared to the supply side. Supply is much, much less than what the demand is. Another thing that in favor of RPA is the non-invasive aspect of RPA, because in RPA, you are not creating any new software. In an integration project, you are creating a software, absolutely. But if I'm able to solve the same problem without creating a new software, then what else do you need as a management? Management would love to have a RPA solution because there is no invasion in my IT landscape. The same work was done earlier by a human being. Now it is done by a software robot. That's it. That's the only difference. And plus I'm getting other benefits of higher work, more accurate work, faster work in less money. So no brainer. That's why RPA is getting so popular. So these are the benefits just I talked about, other than the cost, efficiency, productivity, and accuracy. Yes, now we will be able to have high, you know, more bandwidths to work on interesting things. Human beings are good at innovation, creativity, relationship, communication, organization, team building, troubleshooting. These are our strengths, and this is where we should be spending more time. So RPA is happening a very positive thing to human mankind, because now the boring, mundane, repetitive work can be offloaded to robots, and now human being can work on higher valued items, spend more time on product design, solution building. That is where we should be coming, spending more and more time rather than spending time on the repetitive, boring things. Another advantage of RPA is really in favor of business agility. using RPA for a changing business scenario, I will have a much better opportunity to respond in a timely manner. If I have to integrate my payment system, let's say that I'm using a web interface of a payment system with my internal software, and somebody is actually, you know, has to make the transfer, you know, putting the data, maybe payroll versus, let's take it as a bank versus payroll. And manually, I basically have to create the payroll system for my staff and then upload it onto the bank and then go through the validation, and then some communication happens. Mismatch check has to be done by the accounts and blah, blah, blah. And then finally, it takes, say, half a day to really complete that. Well, no need. Robot will do it for us. Same thing. The actions would be same, but robot will do it. So I will be able to fulfill my requirement much faster. The requirement might arise because of compliance requirement, maybe the competitiveness in the marketplace, but using RPA, I will be able to respond much faster. And that's a big advantage in addition to the other advantages I talked about. All right, so let's stop at this point of time. We have hit a half minute mark. Now, let me just show you a couple of examples. Nothing better than seeing something in action. And then we'll come back to our slides and we'll also build a hands-on session. Let me show you a couple of demos of RPA in action that will give you a better understanding. If you've not seen RPA in action before, then this is your chance. These are very simple automation at the moment. RPA can do much, much, much more complex than what you will see right now. So I'm starting UiPath software. And in this UiPath software, I have already coded the workflow, which my robot will be executing. Let the software load it. In the meantime, I'll show you what exactly will be happening. So I will be having an Excel sheet wherein the accounts department, let's say, has to work on this expense data. So I have this data which is in the form of, say, actuals. And what my robot has to do is has to pick up the actuals and budgeted data and build a comparison month by month against each category and produce a report about the variance. Of course, I can do it, you can do it. Probably, I think you and I probably will be comfortable saying, okay, maybe 15 minutes or so. 15 minutes, I think we will be done. So I'll create a new column here, new column here. I'll copy the budgeted data from here. I'll do A minus B and then sum up all the 12 months. Obviously, I think 15 minutes is fair, 10 to 15 minutes. If you're super efficient, then probably close to 10 minutes. But if I say, okay, make sure that you don't commit any mistake. Oh, then you say, okay, give me some 3, 4, 5 minutes extra because you'll double check, right? Let's see. We'll get this work done by our robot. So my workflow has been loaded and I'm going to run this automation. So what you see on your screen is called workflow. And this workflow, the entire logic has been coded here. My robot will be running this workflow. More on this when we talk about the real training, when we start our training sessions. All this will be discussed in detail, how to build a workflow. There are various types of workflows in UiPath, sequence diagram, flowchart diagram, state machine diagram, and you can use them to build your workflows. You can also call them as process. But a process is constituted of multiple workflows. And you can call one workflow in another workflow. So many things which we'll be learning in the training. Right now, let me run this automation and show you RPA in action. Right now, you can see on my taskbar, there's no Excel sheet open. Right? There's no Excel sheet open. And I'm just going to run it. My robot will open the Excel sheet and will do the job. I'm starting the automation. you will see an icon, UI icon with white background in my taskbar. That is nothing but the robot. So here it is. This robot will now be opening the Excel sheet and will start performing the operations that I would have done if this work was given to me. So right now the data has been copied from the actual sheet and placed into the comparison sheet, where the first column in white background, you can see it as a budgeted sheet. And now for putting the data for the actuals in the individual field. Surely I can apply a formula too. Absolutely. If you're an Excel guy and you understand Excel, surely you can do that, right? Now the bot is doing this, but what if you're not a techie guy? You don't understand how to write, say, macros, or you want to write a formula and stuff like that. And you have to do it on 100 sheets for 100 people. Right? So obviously, it will take time. And remember, I mentioned, make sure that you don't commit any mistake. So obviously you spend more time, but being a robot, yeah, that has already been taken care of. And if I have to apply it on 100 sheets, not a problem. My bot will do it. And by the way, the bot is doing it in front of your eyes, but there's no need. Bot can do it in background. Not need to be in foreground. Wonderful. My bot has done the job and it has given me the variance, which is 1602 euros. I'm very happy. Thank you, robot. Robot has done the job. Well, something which I claim that I will be able to comfortably do in 10 minutes to 15 minutes. My bot has done it in 2 minutes time frame. And also it has sent out a report. So here it is. The report has come with the attachment and the amount, that is the variance. So variance analysis on this sheet is done. Wonderful. So that is RPA in action, something that I could do as a human being manually. Of course, robot has done that same thing for me faster and with accuracy. Let's see another demo. This time I'll show you something more with a larger view. And here in this demo, what I'm going to show you is here, Excel automation, email automation, and desktop application automation are involved. The requirement is like this. I have this data sheet, which is coming from my branches, my bank branches. Say I'm a bank, I have branches. And say in Excel file, I'm getting this data, which is coming from branch. They are sending me the details in terms of these are the account numbers, these are the amounts deposited, and this is the mode of transaction through cash or check. And from all the branches, I'll get this sheet and I need to basically fill up these details by submitting my transactions into the bank's corporate application. So let's say that this is a sample bank application, pretty simple though, but the idea is, I need to enter these details over here. Account number, amount, so some account number, some amount, the mode of transaction, and submit it. A transaction ID is generated by the bank's corporate deposits software. This number, I need to put it into the Excel sheet, which I just showed you, and also update status. If anything goes wrong, then I should record that too. So if you give me this work, then what I will be comfortable with? I'll say at least give me an hour, right? An hour, and because you're saying that make sure that nothing goes wrong. You should not record transaction ID of one transaction into someone else. That would be wrong information. So I'll say, okay, give me 1 hour, maybe 45 minutes. I can do it. If I'm really efficient, maybe 30 minutes. That was, I will not be comfortable below that. If you give me as a human worker, if this work is given to me, right? Let's see how the robot will do it. I'll start this. So first of all, this is the workflow. And the important thing is that the work will not come directly. The work is coming from through an email attachment. My robot will be looking for an email account, will look for an email, particular email. It will start executing it the moment the email comes with the input. Otherwise, it will keep on waiting. So let me close out everything. So right now you can see there's nothing in my system, right? No Excel file, no desktop application. Let me start this automation. You'll see the robot will start running at the taskbar. Now it is running. Nothing is happening. Nothing will happen. My robot is looking for that email to arrive. Okay. Let me send out an email. So I'm sending an email. I'm going to create a new email for my robot. I'll send it to myself because this is what my email account robot is looking for. I'll say bank data. And let's say, hi, please deposit attached transactions in the bank's banking software, something, something. And I'll attach that input file. So let me attach a file. Let's attach this bank data. Now I'll hit on the send button and let's see. The moment email comes, right now bot is not working. The bot is looking for that email to arrive. I'm not touching keyboard and mouse. I'll announce it if I touch. The moment email comes, my bot will start working. The email has come. And I can see the bot has started working. Here it is. The bot has opened the Excel file after downloading it from the email. And now it is picking the data from Excel sheet and placing the data into the corporate banking application. All the transactions generated are getting saved into the Excel file. Now have a look at this transaction, where I deliberately have introduced an error. 50 000 in the amount. That's not a valid number. That's not an amount. It's not a number. And rightly so, the conversion has failed and the robot has noticed it correctly. It's a business exception because the data is invalid. Now let me show you something interesting. Business exceptions are those exceptions which happen because of missing business rule or invalid data, such as the two that you have seen. But there can be system exceptions too. System exceptions are also called as application exceptions. Let me create that. Have you ever noticed when your application crashed or hanged or something? What happens? You try to recover. Now let me just I'm going to pick up the mouse. I'm doing it. I'm going to crash it. I did it. Now I will not touch keyboard and mouse. I'll announce it if I do. My robot has recovered. My robot has recovered from an erroneous situation. Can you see that? It has restarted the application. That's the way workflow has been designed. In case the robot realizes that the application is not accessible, is hanged, is crashed, is down or whatever. And this is what typically happens with us. If a web browser is not loading a page, what do you do? You hit on refresh and it sometimes works. Maybe at the time when you was trying to load it, the network was very slow, the network connection was not up, and number of reasons. Your system was very busy. But when you say restart or reload, it works. If an application has hanged, what do? You kill that through task manager and restart. Well, the robot can do the same thing for us. Wonderful. All right, the robot has done the job, and I can give you the time though. So let's first look at the file, the email system. Yes, the bot has sent out that report as well. Very nice. I'm very happy about this. Let's load this data. And typically, it is taking like 4 seconds per transaction. There are 30 transactions. So you can see there are four seconds per transaction on an average. In some cases, yes, more, because bot was waiting for that application to be there. It realized it is not there, so it has restarted it. So overall, somewhere around 30 transactions into 4 seconds, 120 seconds, 2 minutes. So it has taken 2 minutes to process. Something that I was saying that even if I'm confident and comfortable and I'll be doing it, half an hour is the bare minimum I'll take. Preferably 45 minutes to 1 hour, but 30 minutes is the least that I will take to enter this data and put into the Excel sheet and make sure that everything is right. But bot has done it in 2 minutes, much faster. And by the way, just to repeat, bot can do it in background. No need to have the application open in the foreground. It will be even faster. Excellent. So here in this demo, email automation is involved. My robot is listening to or looking for that email in my email account. Excel automation is involved. As you can see, it is reading and as well as writing the data into the Excel. And also a desktop application is involved. You can very well have the serious applications in place of these. Of course, Excel is very much serious. Email is very much serious. You can have SAP, you can have Salesforce, ServiceNow, whatever it is, n number of applications. IT people can use this software to provision VMs, ticket management, help desk management, health system. RPA is very much applicable in ITSM, IT service management. Okay, let me show you one more demo before we go to the next step. This time I'll show you in the web application. So far you have seen automation running, and by the way, my robot is running. It will continue to run if I don't stop it. So let me stop it now. We are done with this demo because it's listening. If I send another file, another input file, it will start working on that. My third demo is loading up. All right. So in this case, it is basically a web automation where my robot will open a web browser and will perform certain operations. Let me run it and show you this in action. Now everything else will be done by the robot. Robot will open a browser, will go to a particular website and will perform certain operations on the web page. You can see the bot is removing the fields. And now it is going to create a form for me by filling up those details. Looking very nice. This website is basically to generate realistic data set. So here you can see the bot is filling up the form by going to the pop-up screens, filling it up the information. Very nice. Filling up more details. So far, so good. And after filling up the form as per the structure defined, it will download 500 records in Excel format. Just like you and me download files, same is the case. You can see that the download file is starting. And the robot is now clicking on that, clicking on save as, providing the file name, and done. Wonderful. The Excel file has been created. Now the bot is for our display. It will open the Excel file and will also show the first line highlighted. Very nice. So here you can see the Excel file has been loaded with the data is generated by that website, mokaru.com, but my bot has done this job. It has hardly taken a minute to complete the job. And finally, it will close the Excel sheet and all done. Thank you, robot. So you have seen three demos where email automation, Excel automation, desktop automation, web automation, and typically we do only these three. Right? Web applications, desktop application, and documents. That's what we deal with. Okay, let's come back to our presentation. So talking about the market size, a few more slides and then we'll have the hands-on session. The market size is quite big. Right now it is has grown to a very good size, 1.7 billion, but going into the next 3 years, it will be $4.3 billion. Virtually every company is growing in RPA. They're building big, big teams. If you look at the Google Trend portal, and let me show you this in real time. Let me go to my web browser. And let me just go to Google Trend. If you're familiar with Google Trend, probably you will see this something that you probably have already tried. Okay, so I'm going to the trends.google.co.in. And I'm looking at these three leading softwares over the past 5 years trend. It will give you number of information. So it is loading the data, very nice. First thing you can observe that it is basically giving you a very good indicator. First of all, prior to, I would say, you know, mid-2016, or rather I would say beginning of 2017, prior to that, you know, hardly there was any interest, very little, right? Ever since 2017, now we're in 2019, so that means 2 years. So ever since from beginning of 2017, the interest has skyrocketed. This curve is for UiPath, this is for Automation Anywhere, and this is Blue Prism. And in fact, it is telling the stack also, and that is true also from the market position perspective. UiPath has taken a huge lead, and right now you can see it is hitting the interest level. Comparatively, the Automation Anywhere and Blue Prism, I mean, these are also wonderful products, but UiPath has taken a huge lead as compared to the other two leading products. Year and a half back, Automation Anywhere used to be number one, Blue Prism number two, and number three, the UiPath. That was year and a half back. Come forward, total different situation. A number one by huge gap, number two, Automation Anywhere, they're also doing good. All are growing, but the positioning has changed drastically. Today, we have much more licenses sold in UiPath compared to Automation Anywhere and UiPath. Just to surprise you, in the last quarter, not the last quarter that has just passed, the September, or rather October, November, December quarter, UiPath has acquired 8 enterprise customers per day. And perhaps this is the fastest growing company in enterprise product on this planet. And it's true. I'll show you some more numbers just to give you a better understanding where we are heading. All right. So we are a little out of time. So as far as roles are concerned in RPS world, we have all the roles that you typically hear in IT projects: project manager, business analyst, solution architect, developers, testers, supervisors. These supervisor and operations support are basically from the production side rather than the development side. Which are the leading products? We talked about the top three and they stand in that order. Some other worthy names: WorkFusion, OpenSpan, NICE, Cryon, Edgeware from Infosys, Kofax, Thoughtonomy, Redwood, Softomotive, Contextor. Contextor has been acquired by SAP. So much popularity about RPA that giants such as SAP has acquired, and OpenSpan has been acquired by a giant in BPM called Baga System. Another Monday, Ontworks. These are the leader, you know, top 15 companies, but of course the second tier, third tier is nowhere close to the first tier. The top three product names in the industry are UiPath, Automation Anywhere, Blue Prism, and UiPath is taking even further lead as compared to the other two leaders in the market. This is the news that I wanted to share with you. The UiPath was much smaller company, and suddenly in a span of year and a half, it has become a big, huge, I think it will not be unfair if I say giant, it is becoming a giant. So new thing is happening in the IT world, in the automation field. So you can see that in 2018 September, only 6 months back, it was valued at $3 billion. All the leaders are basically, you know, in investment world are investing in it. But there are rumors now that another round of funding will happen later this month. We are in April. And the valuation will be like 6 billion plus. Huge. So what is happening in the valuation world? That is very, very super interesting. So a lot is happening in this world. All right. So with that, I come to towards the end, and it's time to build a small automation so that you have a fair idea how to create a automation. So I'm going to create a new project. Let's call it as, let me just put it onto the desktop. And let's create a project, and I'll name this as UiPath demo. Rest I'll keep as same, no comments, no description. It will create a blank project for me. So my intent is this. My intent is to have a workflow which will open a browser. We'll go to Google homepage. We'll type in weather something, let's say weather London. Then click on this Google search button. Then get the temperature and maybe speak about this temperature rather than doing it. All good? All right. Let's build this and see how simple it would be. Of course, it is very simple automation, but at least it will give you an idea. So open browser. So what we call over here is the activities. Activities are basically action commands, and robot will execute those action commands. So I've added open browser. I've given this URL. Then I have this action. Remember, all we do is clicking and typing. So we have type into action. Similar to these, there are more than 300 actions only from UiPath. And there are hundreds and hundreds of other actions from third party. You can create your own action commands as per your requirements. But by default, there are more than 300, 400 action commands from UiPath alone. Type into is one of them. Open browser is another one. Okay. Now this type into, I've just dragged and dropped into my workflow area. I need to indicate which element I need to type something. Well, I need to type in something this, weather London. But where? So I'll keep my, during the development time, I'll keep my application open, indicate element. And the moment you do so, the studio, this is called studio, will go into the selection mode, and I can select any UI field where I need to operate. Well, I need to operate here. So I'll select this one. Okay, done. Now my robot knows in browser, it needs to type in this field into this particular, this text in this particular UI element. Done. My next action would be the click action. I will drag and drop click. And then I'll perform the click action. So go ahead and click action on this particular field. Done. I can use some feature which I'll explain during the training simulation method that can help us to click on this button directly without any user interface interaction. Okay, my next step would be to get. So far we have done two input action, typing as well as clicking. Now I want to read the data. I've entered the data. Now I'm reading the data. There's one activity called get text, indicate element, and I will have to select that field. So I'll press escape first. I'll expose that field, weather London. And I need to get this temperature, right? I'll indicate this, pick it up, and I can save. So there's a little bit of understanding how to manage data. I'll save this into a variable. So I'm creating a variable with a shortcut method. Let's say temperature and done. Let's display it on the screen. I'll do the message box and I'll simply say temperature in London is plus temperature plus centigrade. So I'm dynamically creating my text, which my robot will display it on screen. Done. Let us close out the browser too. After displaying it, I want to close it. In fact, I can close it just before the display. Why should I have the browser open? Not interested. All I'm interested in the weather. Let's close this browser. I'm all set. I'm all done. I'm going to run this automation now. Everything else will be done by robot. And pay attention. Once the robot starts, it will open up the browser. It will go to the google.com. It will type in weather London. Click on that button. Close out the browser and display me the temperature. Weather in London is 9 degrees Celsius. Fantastic, thank you, and job done. Okay, let's little bit improve it. I don't want my browser to be open. So I will use the simulation method, something called simulation method, and I can run my browser in a hidden mode. What I'm doing right now is basically I'm setting some properties on my activities. So now my browser will run in hidden mode. My activities will work directly on the application, which is the web browser, and all I will get at the end is the display of temperature. Let's run it. I'm starting it. And this time you'll see no browser will open. Nothing. It is working in background. All you will get is the final result. Fantastic. Job done. Pretty simple. Okay. Let's for fun, just for fun, let me just also have a speech. Instead of me seeing the message box, I would like to hear from robot. Now there's something called as package. So I'm going to install a package called speech package. So let me just install a speech package. All this will be discussed in detail. What is a package? How you can install a third party package and use the activities from there. So right now I'm installing a third party package for converting text into speech. And that's what I'm doing right now. I got additional activities now. I'll drag and drop. I'll copy this entire text. In the speech properties, I'll set these properties. So normal speed, the text I want my robot to speak, and the maximum volume. Now I don't need the message box. Done. Instead, I'm using the speech. I'm all set. Let's run it. Again, this time, nothing will open up, including the message box. You will listen to the robot. Robot will speak to us.
Temperature in London is 9 degrees Celsius.
I hope you have heard that robot has spoken to us. Okay, great. So that is a demo that, or the hands-on, we have created a real automation. And you can see how simple it is. Of course, you can do much, much, much more complex than this, but you got the idea how a RPA is program is built and how you can automate your steps, your actions. A couple of more slides and then we'll go into the Q&A. Feel free to post your questions in parallel. So we are coming up with a training program starting from 20th of April. The agenda would be to cover up L1 and L2 certification, and we'll also have introduction to advanced topics such as framework. In the training, we'll be covering about introduction to RPA, UiPath. We'll learn about UI automation, the programming and data manipulation aspect of RPA, how to automate images, how to use OCR technology to convert image-based text into normal native text, Excel automation, PDF automation, and email automation will be taught. Very interesting topic of orchestrator, which is the server side of RPA UI path. How to automate SAP and how to automate mainframe terminals. And also talk about advanced topics involved in RPA. The program that I was talking about today is 9th, where we are having the demo. On 20th, Saturday morning, 9 a.m., we are starting this training program for six weekend days, Saturday, Sunday, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. India Standard Time, with a small break in between. Now I'm ready with to answer your questions. I know that we have overstepped our scheduled time, so 9 minutes over our scheduled time, but I'm more than happy to take your questions. Let me open the chat window and see how many questions have been posted so far. All right. First question is coming from Mohammed. How would it handle the time lapse if this is, it does not find the element where it has to insert the data, means required element is not loaded? Will it wait till the element is not visible? Very good question. So by default in UI path, every action will wait for 30 seconds. But what if 30 seconds, the element is not ready, is not available, not visible? Yes, in that case, it will throw an exception. If you are talking about the element not available, then in UiPath terminology, it will be selector not found exception. You can certainly can manage your timeout duration, which is by default 30 seconds. You can reduce or increase it. Having said this, there are much better options available to build your automation, which can wait in a judicious manner. For example, just like you and I, for example, if I ask you, tell me when you download a file, let's say 1 GB, when do you know it will finish? You say, no, I don't know. I will know only when the download, say maybe a tracker or something that you see as a pop-up window. Once the download is complete, whether it is done in 1 minute or 5 minutes or 7 minutes, depending on your internet connection. Once that window disappears, that means download is complete, right? That's a fair way of looking at it. Well, same thing, the robot will do it. So I can have, first of all, the standard timeout. Yes, if element is not there, after 30 seconds, it will throw an exception. And then as a automation engineer, we will have to handle exceptions in a graceful manner so that nothing crashes. But we can have even better automation wherein my robot can wait for some time depending on some UI event happen. And accordingly, I can my robot can take a decision much better way rather than just a timeout. So there are activities which you can use on element appear, on element vanish, and many similar activities like image exist, element exist, and stuff like that to even make it more reliable. So it can wait. It can wait to become visible. But of course, nobody will write a code which will wait indefinitely. Absolutely. Okay. Any other question? That was the only question I could see. Okay. Kumar has given another question. What are the job opportunities in RPA UiPath world? Can a QA developer easily transform? Yes. And this is one of the common question that comes. So as far as the job opportunities in RPA UiPath is concerned, I would encourage you to do your own little bit of exercise. Go to portals such as Naukri or Monster. Go to portals such as DICE and look at for the jobs. The job opportunities are huge. I've come back from running a couple of batches for TCS, Infosys, and they are not able to get people from the market. So that is why I've executed their program internal. So many people from the QA world are coming into this, especially people who have worked in the QA automation, because some of the technology is very similar in RPA, as you can see in QA automation, such as Selenium. But yes, here the programming aspect is not that much as you typically would have in Selenium. But point is, Selenium is only for testing. That's the core use of the Selenium. RPA is totally different. It's apple to orange comparison. RPA is all about process automation, process. Not just simply a testing software for a software. UiPath provides three levels of certification, and this course will prepare you for L1 and L2 certification. So level one, level two, level three, all are free. No cost involved. Good news is there's a next level two, which is a official, or rather I should say formal exam. So level one, level two, level three, these are the three certifications, and let me just open quickly so that you can see it even better. So RPA, virtually everyone, people from operations, people from business side, process owners, QA, QA automation, and even developers, all are very much suitable for RPA and can build a career in RPA. And as I mentioned, demand supply gap is huge right now. Companies like TCS are looking in thousands. I've trained 72 of their professionals a couple of weeks back, and there were other parallel batches were going on. So from RPA perspective, the certification, the question was for certification. So level one is called RPA Developer Foundation Training. It is free. Then level two is about orchestrator. This certification is also free. Once you learn about development and the server side of RPA, then you can appear on for this L1 and L2 certifications, and you can get it done without any money involved. After this, there is a level three also, which is advanced developer certification. And in this, the robotic enterprise framework is used, and you will have to build your automation on RE framework. In the course that we have designed and which we will be sharing, we'll be talking about, we will be giving a introduction about the RE framework so that you can pick it up. In addition to this, good news for everyone is that there's a formal certification exam from UiPath. It is a prized one. There's a money involved. It was free till 31st of March 2019. Now, good news is that that has been extended to 30th of June. So 3 months extension. So you have 3 months. So if you clear L1, L2 and L3, if you prepare, then you'll be ready for appearing for this exam. And if you get all the L1, L2, L3, I mean, it's good enough for fetching a job. And of course, if you do this in addition without any money involved, that will be even better. I hope I've answered your question, Kumar. From Raju's, Raju S, for QA automation, we have Selenium and other tools that, and what different approach RPA provides, can you please elaborate? Sure. See, the one that, the few demos that I've shown you and one hands-on, it was basically a small part of the process. Again, you have to go back to the one explanation, one process detail I was showing you in swim lanes, where multiple roles are working with different softwares to create a line of credit account. Now, that's a realistic use case. Think about it. There can be 50 such automations within that process, like, you know, one that you have seen, picking the data from email, putting the data. Yeah, that can be one single step out of total 50 steps. Let's say, hypothetically, I'm saying that will constitute a process. So the ability to run a process from start to end is what RPA is all about. Well, for that matter, I mean, because we are comparing Selenium or QA automation with RPA, well, I will compare RPA with autonomous cars. because they also use the same technology what RPA is using. What an autonomous car is using? Computer vision. RPA is all about computer vision. In RPA, we use the image comparison. We use the OCR technology, optical character recognition, to read image-based text, and then we process it down the stream in the process. Think about an autonomous car, which is also doing the similar stuff. It is actually taking screenshots of the surroundings in front and surroundings, and then comparing it with something that it has in its database. And also at times, like so say stop is written on a sign, it is basically applying OCR, the autonomous car, and saying, okay, it is stop. And when it says stop, stop means you apply brake. Brake means you have to stop before that sign. Well, that is RPA. So the point is that their underlying technology can be similar, like in Selenium we do use, but the playground is totally different. In case of RPA, the playground is super big, I would say, because the domain area is totally different. Even though technology are similar, the underlying technology, some component of underlying technology is similar. So yes, you basically have the different problem set to solve using RPA, which is nothing but process automation. Process automation is the core, wherein using RPA now we will be able to automate processes. Think about of workload management. Think about how would you perform as a manager, let's say, and you want to get 100 applications processed every day when one team member can do only 10 maximum. No brainer, you would ask for 10 people team so that you can achieve the daily traffic processing goal. If tomorrow the traffic goes to double, you will need 20. Well, same goes true with RPA in the digital worker. So it's not testing or the QA perspective. Here you are basically performing the real execution aspect of a process. The robots are working just like you and me. And they are working on the actual process. That's robotics. And of course, underlying technology is computer vision, document processing, UI automation, desktop application automation, Citrix automation, email automation, Excel automation, PDF, all those things. So these are the different things, which basically we are now using. We are doing the screen scraping, we are doing the data scraping, we are doing the computer vision. All those are the basically bundled together as one combined technology now, RPA, which we are applying in process automation. Process primarily in business domain and also in IT aspect as well, ITSM. I hope I've elaborated enough for you, Raju. All right, wonderful, thank you. So any other question from anyone? Amit, Anshika, Ashok, Ashta, Deepti, Mohammed, Raju, Rashmi, Ravi, Srinivasan, Tripta. I will be more than happy to answer your question.
Can we ask an audio question instead of
writing? Sure, absolutely, most welcome.
Okay, so my question was on, you know, the test process automation, whatever we do, right? So in the normal world, we have Selenium scripts to automate our, you know, UI application, UI API and mobile applications and all. So my question was like, you know, whenever the test scripts fails, we have to go over there and analyze, and if what is the issue over there, we have to analyze and we have to fix it, whether it is a test data issue or something. Majorly, this case is failed because of the test data, right? So do we have any, you know, options in RPA to fix that kind of issues? Because when we speak about robotic, it should analyze that one, right? Giving the backsides, you know, statistics and all, what are the test case fail statistics? taking the whatever the fixed advantage over there. That's what I researched on the online, like it, you know, it will read on the statistics built on the failed scenarios, how it fixed, and it will learn automatically. Is that the thing happening in this RPA UI?
Yes, very much. So that's the next level of RPA, which is intelligent RPA. It is also called as intelligent process automation, IPA. Mm-hmm. Now, the point is that the robot can learn, just like you and I can learn, from our previous actions. So we are what we are because of our education, because of our experience, because of our learnings from our earlier mistakes. Same way the robot can learn from the previous data. So for example, let's say that robot is performing certain operations and it is failing to make an entry. Now, obviously, initially it won't have any idea why it is failing. Now, let's say that let's take the example what I've shown you earlier, where the space was there, right? So 50 space 000, 100 space 000, and it was failing. It was not able to make the entry. And rightly so, that's the normal behavior, invalid data. It has to fail. But can a robot fix that once it has learned enough? Answer is yes. What I can do on top of RPA, I can build a machine learning algorithm based on the responses given to these mistakes in the past.
Okay.
If, say, mistake has happened, which is 50 space 00, obviously the robot initially will put into the exception queue, which has been the case in our demo, the three highlighted one. And let's say that as a human intervention, I will go into and I'll fix it. So earlier it was 50 space 00. My response is 50 0 0 0, no space, I've deleted it. That's my response, right? Again, another instance has happened where 100 space 00 was there. Again, as a human being, the robot has failed, rightly so, but I'm going to now fix it by putting replacing that space.
Okay.
Done. This will happen again and again, again and again. Let's say it has happened 50 times. Mm-hmm. And there can be other issues too, some other challenge. Mm-hmm. If that happens, and now my robot knows that whenever there is a situation, a pattern, wherever there's a space in between number, the response has been very simple, removing the space. Mm-hmm. And once, based on my machine learning algorithm, and we call it a confidence level, once you achieve the confidence level that, okay, it's 90% confidence that whenever a number comes out with this, where the space is removed by the human interaction, the next time onwards, the robot will do that job automatically, will remove that space. Because now it has learned from the previous 50 instances that whenever it happens, the only response by the human interaction is to remove that space, and thereafter it works fine. The robot, based on that learning, will now next time, whenever it happens, when the confidence level has achieved, which we were aiming at least 90%, let's say, the robot will correct it on its own without really programming it. So yes, robot can learn and can do things like the one I have explained. This is much simpler. It can do much, much complex. For example, let's say that you have the text, the text you're reading from your email, your social media or PDF documents and all that. Mm-hmm. How do you know that what is written on that? Well, you know it because you know that language. A. B, you have gone through your education and you understand the meaning of sentences, phrases, and even you can go beyond that, what the tone of that language is. So many things, right? Mm-hmm. So you understand sentiment, you understand whether it is what is the purpose of it and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Now, this is based on your knowledge of language, your knowledge of the context. And that basis that you basically conclude, okay, this is what is the case. Well, the same way the RPA robot can apply a technology which is called NLP, natural language processing. The same way as our brain works, based on our knowledge of the language, my robot can apply the same technique with the NLP technology to understand the text. Now, this text could be positive sentiment, negative sentiments, very positive, very negative. For example, if I say, I love Delhi, three words only, I love Delhi. What is the meaning? Well, the meaning is very simple. You should be analyzing this sentence like this. I means, of course, it is referred to a human being. Love means a very positive, very strong positive feeling. Delhi, well, Delhi is a space, is a place somewhere in India, which happens to be the capital of the India, right? This knowledge is available. This knowledge is available everywhere, right? So now my robot can very well say that, okay, some human being has a very positive feeling about a place. Mm-hmm. Understood. Robot understood. Of course, it may not understood the way you and I understand initially, but at least first level of understanding is there. Great enough. Now, can't my robot make further processing or further decision making based on this knowledge? Think about of a customer service. Mm-hmm. Now, if I have, say, let's say that I have launched a product on Amazon.in, mm-hmm. and my, you know, I've set up a 5-member team just to look for the feedback. So hundreds of feedbacks are coming from customer, and to make sure that my customer is not getting negative feedback, it's on the high, you know, bracket as far as the customer satisfaction is concerned. I have given the directions to these 5 individuals to respond to any negative feedback immediately and solve their problem. If somebody saying my product was delivered with damage, respond and say cashback of 1,000 rupees we are giving and say sorry, and similarly keep going. Now, of course, these people are reading those content, right? Somebody has written, I got the product, but it was damaged. I'm very unhappy about it. Wish I could not order this, product in first place. Hope I did not, order this. Okay. You're reading as a human being and you're able to conclude. My robot using NLP can conclude it. My robot can, offer that 1,000 rupees as a cashback. And likewise, similar responses. So yes, RPA can surely is going to the next level where my robot can learn from the previous data. Talking about Selenium and other related technology, again, of course, you can do the analytics. It's again data analytics, and you can apply some intelligence over there. In fact, everyone is going towards that direction. But I think the fact that we should appreciate in favor of RPA is that it is all about process automation. All the things involved in a process execution in a real business world is what basically RPA is automating. And that is why it is getting popularity. Cool. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Most welcome. Mohammed has sent another question. So whatever actions we take here on UI will create any script behind the scene, and when those script will store, and how can we understand? Okay. So there's no script as such, but yes, there's a workflow. So what you have seen in front of your eyes, this is a workflow. This workflow gets stored into a XAML file, XAML file, which is pronounced as XAML, and it's all about XML. So yes, you may call it as a script, but I won't call it as a script. It's a workflow file. This XAML is created by Microsoft. So if I open this XAML file in a Notepad++, we should not be dealing with this first of all. So my entire workflow is in this XML file, which is as per the structure standard created by Microsoft to store workflows. So yeah, this is the script, and this is what robot is executing. But normally we never modify it manually. Wonderful. All right, so let me conclude here. That was the last question in queue. So thank you everyone for your time today. Really appreciate if you have taken time out from your daily routine. If you like the session and you would like to learn more, and you want to add the skills which can help you in your current job, maybe in a new career, I will welcome you to join our trainee program starting on 20th of April. You may get in touch with the DevLab Alliance for more details, and we will be more than happy to answer your questions. I hope I'll see you in the training program. With that, have a wonderful time. We'll see you in the training once you decide to join in. Bye for now.
Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.